to our YAP Ireland webinar, Building Strengths Together, which is the theme of today's webinar. And I'm delighted to welcome our speakers, our young people and parents and carers who are joining us, and all our partners, the board members and staff. I suppose a big thank you straight away to all the people who helped to put the material for today's webinar together, especially the young people. And Graham, who has actually pulled it all together for us. Just to say that the webinar will be recorded, so for anyone who misses it, or if anybody, you know, would be interested, you can always send them the link. So it'll be up on the website sometime later this week. Also, we have the chat box there, so please feel free to send in comments. As usual with YAP Ireland, we have a multimedia presentation of videos, artwork, poetry, song, and then our speakers, which who we've invited to address the topic of building strengths together. This is an exciting time for YAP Ireland. The outcomes in our annual report show the ongoing success of the model and the way of working with young people and families to help them to achieve their goals. And that's really built on building the strengths of the young people and families that we work with and building community support around them. So we're very pleased to be launching our annual report today and also our new strategic plan. We celebrated 20 years of service in Ireland in 2022, and we look forward to another at least 20 years. First of all, to get us started, I'd like to introduce Raideen Dunn, who's the chair of the YAP Ireland board. Raideen.
Good morning, everybody. I'm delighted to be here as chair of the board of YAP at this really exciting time in YAP's service delivery as we look back on 20 years and we look forward with our annual report and our new strategic plan. On behalf of the board, I'd really like to thank all of our stakeholders in YAP, our amazing staff, our executive team, our children and young people. I don't know if there's any other service that can be as responsive to children and young people as YAP. And I believe that comes from the strengths-based model that is held so dearly by everybody in YAP. I suppose when children and families come across systems, we can focus on risk and we can focus on issues. And what YAP try to do is try to hold the hand of a young person to remind them that they have strengths and they have innate value just as they are. Sometimes when life is tough, they may forget that, but YAP does that so well, reminding families and children and young people just what it is that makes them individual and unique and so important. And one of the great gifts of my life is being chair of the board and seeing how the young person is so central to the work that we do. So looking back on 2022, what a year we had. Over 3,748 young people and families engaged in our service. The actual, to use an awful word, the ability of YAP to pivot, to be responsive to needs of young people was totally evidenced in our new services, such as our Tuisla Education Support Service, our advocacy, independent advocacy service, particularly in the areas of CAMHS, our unaccompanied asylum and seeking children services, our YAP ability, our intensive support services. So I am really looking forward to hearing how we can grow together and continue to focus on that strengths-based approach, which I think we lose so much in the work that we do. So enjoy, everybody, and I look forward to hearing what everyone has to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Raideen. As always, you hit the nail on the head. And we are celebrating 20 years of service. And we have definitely grown in those 20 years from our very small beginnings in Galway and Roscommon, Meath and North Dublin to being in all counties across Ireland, except a couple. So those people from those couple need to get on about why they were not there yet. But also we've seen growth, as you've said, in independent advocacy services, our services at the HSE in relation to YAP ability. And we've also seen increases in our work with our new pilot this year, or last year with TESS, the Tuisla Education Support Service, which again, as early intervention, is really, really important. And we're really looking forward to seeing the outcomes from that pilot. Yap Inc., as you know, our American partner set up Yap Ireland in 2008, and they have supported our development at all times into a separate organization. And we still work very, very closely with Yap Inc. Share board members, but also share a lot of research and support in relation to outcomes and monitoring, etc. So Gary Ivory, who's the president of Yap Inc., was unable to join us today, but he has sent us a video, so we'll show that video now. We hope. The best laid plans and all that. There we go.
So hello, I'm Kelly Williams. I'm Chief of Marketing and Communications for Yap Inc. in the United States Youth Advocate Programs. And we call ourselves Yap, just like you do in Ireland. And I am with Gary Ivory. Gary is our president and interim CEO. And Gary is going to talk to us a little bit about the relationship between Yap Inc. and Yap Ireland. So welcome, Gary.
Thank you, Kelly. Glad to be here.
Cool. So if you can just tell me a little bit, you know, the theme today is building strengths together. So when you think about that, what comes to mind?
Well, thank you for the question. And first of all, what comes to mind is YAP is a strength-based organization. Instead of being deficit-based and pathology-focused, we focus on strengths. And we think that's very, very compelling in our model. And so I also think about a theme this year, 2023, that we're doing in the United States and all 34 states, which is back to basics, really ensuring that we understand the guiding principles that brought us here for 48 years in the United States.
The model is really simple too, isn't it, Gary? Talk to us a little bit about the model itself.
Yes, developing a very individualized plan with the young people and the families' participation in designing or co-authoring that plan. The focus on the entire family, we think, is very, very important, not just on the young person's needs, but the family's needs. All of those things are very integral in implementing this model. But the key is really the neighborhood-based recruitment of our staff. They know the local environment, they know the local conditions and local resources, and we think that's powerful.
Gary, can you just tell me a little bit about the relationship between Yap Inc. and Yap Ireland?
And Dr. Bill Lockhart, who was a well-known mediator and peacemaker in Northern Ireland, heard about the work that we were doing in the United States. And after he heard about that work that we were doing, he invited a delegation of government officials to visit our programs in Tarrant County, Texas, as well as in New York State. Those U.S. visits led to a formal agreement in 2002 to begin programs in Dublin, Galway, and a few other counties.
When did we really know that it was working in Ireland?
Well, first, yeah, we always want to measure the impact we're having. We want to measure outcomes. So in Ireland, Dr. Pat Dolan at the University of Ireland, Galway, was contracted to do the first evaluation of our program results in Ireland, and they were very, very positive. We do a lot of monitoring in the United States, and Ireland adopted that practice as well, and to great success. And lastly, I'll say they empowered the young people and families so that once formal services ended, their needs were being met and they had voice and choice.
Thank you, Gary.
Thank you, Kelly.
Well, just to pick up on the theme, thanks very much to Gary and Kelly there for sending us that video. But picking up on the theme of building on the strengths of young people and families, the outcomes and the annual report, which is available on the website, and I know some people will also receive hard copies and soft copies via email. But the outcomes show the ongoing importance of aspects of the improvement and the aspects of the lives that help us, the young people, to achieve their goals. To highlight just a few, 81% showed an improvement in self-esteem and confidence, and 81% in emotional well-being. 77% improvement in feeling withdrawn and isolated. I mean, for YAP Ireland, these are all very important indicators because they indicate the building of resilience within the young people and families themselves, which gives them the confidence to go on and fully participate in their families, their schools, and their communities. The model also is a very practical model with an 86% improvement in home, physical, and financial, which illustrates the importance of supporting young people and families to ensure they have all their entitlements and their rights are upheld, as well as linking them into services that support them. A high number of the young people and families who come to YAP Ireland are living in areas of high deprivation and poverty. And it's very, very important that when we're looking at what are the strengths and how do we support people to move on in their lives, that we're not ignoring those actual facts and that we're making sure that we're building support for young people and families to be able to meet their goals, despite sometimes the barriers that are put in their way. With the monitoring calls, we show, again, we've lots and lots of comments from the young people. We have monitoring calls with parents. We have questionnaires with young people and with referrers. And 95% of parents scored YAP 4 out of 5, with 89% of young people giving positive feedback. And 100% of social workers who referred said they would recommend YAP to a colleague. And just to finish on this little theme of how does YAP work, Taylor, who's one of our young people who's joining us today, so welcome, Taylor. He sent us through some comments and indeed pointers for life that are very, very important. So he said, my experience with YAP has been something that has inspired me to build my confidence, to do stuff for myself without needing another set of hands to help me. I so far have the confidence and independence to speak for myself in everyday life situations. This is only how my YAP worker helped support me with the YAP program. And then he's given us all some little hints for how we should think about things in life. So no one is perfect. That's why pencils have erasers. Happiness is the only thing that multiplies when you share it. Live life to the fullest and focus on the positive. Keep your face to the sunshine and you cannot see a shadow. So I think we can all take that with us today. Very, very important words. So I want to thank Taylor again. We're now going to have a short video from Cabha Monaghan on the same theme.
Hello, my name is Audis Hondesmello and I'm a young person from YAP. Before I started this programme, I always thought that I was looked down on because of where I came from, family history, etc. I thought that my opinion didn't matter to no one, including myself. When I started this programme 6 months ago, I definitely didn't expect to be where I am today. 6 months ago, I had no confidence and never communicated how I felt. I also felt that I didn't have control in certain situations which I should have had control in. But now, 6 months in, I always make sure that my voice is heard. Because this programme has showed me that it doesn't matter where you come from, what sexuality you are, what race you are, that you are enough. And you have a right to have your voice and your opinion heard. You also have a right to go and pursue whatever goals or plans that you have for yourself. The road may not always be easy, but if you put in enough work and do the best that you can, you'll always get there in the end.
Great. Thank you so much. As people know, in 2022, the UCO group chose to work with me on the topic of education for all. They were a really great bunch of young people, and I learned a huge amount from working with them. One of the things that they did as part of the project was to interview Niall Muldoon, our Ombudsman for Children. And I'm delighted to introduce him to speak now. The booklet is available on the website for those who didn't get it. And after Niall speaks, he will be followed by a wrap on education. It was actually written and filmed by young people in 2012. And some of the same themes came through again almost 11 years later. So thank you, Niall.
Thank you very much, Siobhan. Absolutely delighted to be here. And thankfully, I won't be doing any rapping. But I want to say congratulations to YAP for their 20th birthday. It's a fantastic achievement. And I've been very, very lucky to be able to walk with you the last 8 years I've been involved as Ombudsman. You've been really inspirational organization. Particular thanks today to Siobhan and to Radin for inviting me to be part of this very exciting day. What a momentous day for any organization to be able to present both an annual report and a strategic plan at the same time. I know personally from the experience of putting them together, the long, arduous hours were put into it, and undoubtedly frustration and difficult decisions being made as you go along. So fair play to all involved in bringing the hundreds of hours together and producing both of these excellent documents. Your strategic plan talks about diversifying and ensuring more children get access to your services. It also talks about increasing the opportunities for children and their family carers to influence societal change. I mean, what a fantastic target. You're saying to the young people who are in difficulty and to their families who need help, not only will we help you, but we will also help you to change society. What a wonderful goal and what a wonderful achievement you've done with in the many years you've been doing this, because we know it's not empty rhetoric. It's just building on what you've already achieved over the last 20 years. And I know you will have more massively positive impact over the next number of years up to 2026. And the work that you do is community-based, it's strength-focused, it's inclusive, and it's flexible. And for me, that's the very essence of children's rights in action. That's children's rights on the ground. It encompasses non-discrimination, Article 2, your inclusivity of children who need your help, and your, I know Radin used it, doesn't like the word pivoting, neither do I, but your flexibility and your ability to engage with children who need your help at different times over the last 20 years has been hugely important, including children who needed help through the COVID crisis, who wouldn't normally be on your radar, Ukrainian children, children in international protection, and so many others that would not normally have been in your remit. You've been willing to do that, and you've shown that. You've also looked at you're continuously raising the voice of the child through focusing on their strengths and allowing them to recognize they have a voice. And your video from Cavan was perfect example of that. A young person who couldn't recognize themselves 6 months after interacting with yourselves. And also using their community helps to raise their voice, because the people around them are change and adapt and grow and see their strengths. That's Article 12 covered. You incorporate the best interest principle all the time by ensuring that you are flexible and you're working with the community to maximize the benefits of the work you do long term. So their best interests are always catered for and always part of what you're building towards. And finally, and that's Article 3. Finally, overall, by being in existence and doing what you do for children and their families, you're helping to the maximum extent possible the survival and development of the child. And that's Article 6. So for me as Ombudsman for Children, I just want to say a huge thank you to YAP and to everybody involved in it from the bottom of my heart, because you're doing our work. You're promoting and protecting children's rights at every turn. And in that vein, I really want to thank you for the work you've done and continue to do for the children who are vulnerable because of their mental health issues. I know that the work of YAP as independent advocates in that space has grown to include CAMHS as well as inpatient settings. And I was delighted to be involved at the first inpatient setting in St. John of God's back in 2017. And thank you for taking on such work. I also know Minister Butler is going to be speaking later on, and I really hope that she understands the value of what you're doing for these children and their families. And that I hope that she's providing YAP with the appropriate level of funding and resources to do a job, which the UN Committee on the Rights of the Child have recommended to the state that they must do. And they've recommended that on a number of occasions. So YAP is fulfilling that role, but it needs to be fully funded and it needs to be nationwide so that all children can have all that independent advocate speak for them. I recently found a quote that I really liked, and I think it's apt for YAP. Unfortunately, I don't have an author for it, and so I'm calling it anonymous, but I think it's very simple, but it also encompasses what I believe you do. It says, hospitality means extending to strangers a quality of kindness usually reserved for family and friends. And I think that's how YAP goes about its work. And I think it's also why YAP is so successful. You give that level of hospitality and kindness to people who don't know you and who didn't know you existed, so that they can grow in the strengths that they have and become self-sufficient, which again is one of the greatest gifts you can give to any young person and family. So I'm just going to sign off now by saying, keep it up. I look forward to the next 20 years, and any help I can give you in that time, I'd be delighted to do. And I want to wish you the very best of luck in implementing this new strategy, and congratulations on the magnificent work you've done over 2022. Thank you very much.
It doesn't matter if you like school or not. It's alright, education is alright. It doesn't matter if you like school or not. It's your life. Live well before you die. Live well before you die.
I ain't into SMM, but my whips off the chain with a little drop of claim that drops off the frame with that twisted ass morning. Got a pencil for a brain, a razor for a head, fucking pencil for a frame with I never use, unkilled, unskilled. So listen up as I preach about you reaching first, cause you're just at loss, at loss. Just trust yourself, start going to first, but I was fucked out for giving the teacher stick, cause they don't want me, they flunk me as a bad example, but I'm able for it, for life going through trouble and strife, unleashed and unteached.
Up 6 to 7am, God it's a pain, it's the start of the day. Oh, so I grab a good feed to give me what I need as I leave. Going for the bus, but I try not to make a lot of fuss. Not much of it anyway, on the bus. Yo, did you hear that Susanna got dumped? No, I say, as I ride for the school, I'm entering into the first lesson. I'm stressing, test the book set for the day that I begin to be sweating. As I go through the day stepping, going through all my lessons. Chilling with my friends, but I spend the rest of the day spacing. But I learn what I can, try to be the best and beat the rest. As I move on to the next step, on and on I go. Class by class, trying to reach a laugh, but enjoy the day as I go. Sticking to the rules, and not to stand stupid. Corny, but a life in school can be cool. Now the moral of the story is like treating you like dry sod, kicking back in his face. Now by God, it's Wesley and Garrett Dunn. Now you know the boy's gonna be good. School for you reach. Check out the beat, stay in your seats, no objections. The song goes on to the next section.
It doesn't matter if you like it or not. And it's alright, education is alright. It doesn't matter if you like it or not. It's
yes, we know we have to be teached, but we still can't stand around 2 feet. Working a couple of days, being paid, unlike school, you're all just fools, thinking all cool. No, man, you're all just dirty knackers. We still have to explain why we don't like school. We prefer to take the easy way in life, it's cool. We go to war with teachers because they always preach at us and to be yelled at us. But fuck that, we'd rather stay in bed for a bit longer and just ponder. I lie in bed all day dreaming life away, because in school they have no pay. So I say each day I wake up, these easy going days pay as respect about my happy days at Utrecht.
It doesn't matter if
Now at school you gotta live it to fit it, and if you didn't you wouldn't get it, or see what the big deal is, why it was the silliest, to be walking the borderline of your life's city limits. It's different, it's a certain significance, a certificate of authenticity you never even see, but it's everything to me, it's my credibility. Now about life, it needs to be a good one, it's cool to have you got a nice one, you can end up even being a worldwide phenomenon. Now you might need help if you want to world the world, and the only way to do it is to have a life in school, cause you need your education, you might do well for this nation, move up to the highest station, being in the Phoenix Park as a president. Now we're selling this to all of you who don't like to be teach. Those of you who drop school and swap on to youth reach. But don't is what I'm trying to preach. If it's good life you're trying to reach, just trust yourself, you'll go somewhere. Cause when you wake up you still be you, but someone just might care.
Sorry, and just at that moment, the dog decided to bark as well. So thank you so much, Niall. That was great. And I loved your quote there. I think, you hear a lot of talk at the moment about kindness. And I think that's really, really important. It's very, very underrated about how a small amount of kindness and being kind to each other is so important. But also the hospitality, and certainly the young people and families will always say that sharing food together, having pizza is very important, or Chinese. When we're doing our groups, we always have to have big conversations about what food is the most appropriate and who's getting what. And that's really, really important though, because there's something about sitting down together and feeling cared for and nourished that is really, really important. And that is definitely a big part of the work, and same with our parents groups as well. I suppose just that video just reminds me so much, you know, at least two of those young people were homeless at the time that they were involved with us at that time in that group doing that work. And they got together as a group. They turned up all the time. They worked really closely with the staff, who were unbelievable. And they wrote that rap, they recorded it, and then they filmed it. And just for them, that achievement, and for us to see that achievement, I mean, that is something that they will never forget, and neither will we. And it's really, really important. And the themes, obviously, to some extent, still do hold true today, as we found when this current group of young people were looking at education again. I suppose particularly the fact that young people who aren't in mainstream education really feel that the alternatives are not seen as positive, that they're undermined, that they're seen as second class in some way. And I think for all of us, we really have to change that. Because some young people do need alternative education models, because our current education model does not adapt to suit their needs. Everybody has to adapt to it. So that's a really, really important message that still comes across. So thank you very much, Niall. I'd now like to introduce Tanya Ward, who's the Chief Executive of the Children's Rights Alliance. And again, the Children's Rights Alliance are at the forefront of fighting for children's rights in Ireland, for policy change, for negotiation around how to improve services. And we work very, very closely with them, as do some of our young people and parents over the years. And so it's a really important partnership that we have. So Tanya.
Thanks, Siobhan, and thanks for the invitation to be part of this event. I was delighted to get the invitation, to be honest, because every time I take part in an event that YAP does, I always learn something new. And you're so good at elevating the work of YAP, you know, and being able to communicate it out to the outside world about what the organisation do. and to demonstrate the empowerment that's happened with children and young people that are working through your services. I suppose I was asked to talk about YAP and its work with the Children's Rights Alliance and from a children's rights perspective. And I suppose I'll come at it at a slightly different angle than Niall. First off, I said I'm disappointed Niall didn't do a rap because, you know, there's a great rap there. But one of the things that really strikes me about YAP and the work I see taking place is Niall outlined like what children's rights are, you know, the principle of non-discrimination, the right to survival and development, and Article 12 around the voice of the child. And what's very clear to me, the way YAP does its work, it's, you know, it's some best in class child and youth participation practice in Ireland is happening in this youth organization. I mean, there's very few organizations that have a CEO group working with the CEO, you know, promoting that form of leadership and participation in decision making within the organization. And one of the things I see is that that practice filters down at all areas, including from the board all the way down to the child-led work that actually happens on the ground. So it's a model which, you know, others should be following in practice. And then when you look at the work that YAP does itself, I mean, Children's Rights Alliance is campaigning, particularly in the areas of poverty and in education. That's what our members really want us to focus on. And we've some very, and these are very serious issues that are facing some of the children and young people that YAP work with. But also, you know, we campaign in the area of trying to protect children from exploitation, and harm that might come to them, promote their right to protection, and promote family support. And one of the things about YAP services is it's very much in line with what is actually needed to address those kind of issues. I was minded to look at the Council of Europe's recommendations around child-friendly social services. And that's about, you know, how you promote children's rights approach in social services. And if you look at what YAP is doing, it's bang on in line with what the Council of Europe is saying is best practice in this field. The fact that it does provide this child-led advocacy type approach, and alongside that, it promotes family support services and it provides these intensive social services. All of that is actually what the government should be providing and supporting. And it's great to see that that's actually taking place. One of the things I think as well that's really important from a values point of view, and we know in the research, and it's hard to see the rap, to be honest, and see the same issues coming up again and again in education. It is often hard to change things in education because it is a very, it's like a juggernaut. It's a very big system. It can be very hard to shift direction in it. And as you say, Siobhan, one of the challenges is it's one size fits all, works for a lot of young people, but not for others. And alternatives are really necessary. But one of the things I think is really important with the YAP's work, and this is, should be a value that permeates all education, is ensuring that children and young people get to reach their full potential. I mean, in terms of all the research that's done, why do young people not progress in life? Often one of the reasons is they've never been told they can. Basically, all the adults in their lives are putting the lid on them and trying to squeeze out their potential. And that's one of the things, this intervention that YAP promotes, it actually helps young people reach their full potential. And you can see that from the other story earlier on in the event. And I suppose the last thing then I want to bring attention, I suppose, from YAP's approach and from a children's rights approach, what does YAP do? The one of the things that's really important if you're doing really good children's rights work is to identify and document issues that the young people that you're working with face. And YAP do that really well. We facilitate a dialogue between the members and TUSLA, who's the National Child and Family Agency. And what's really critical about the interventions from YAP, not just through our work but through others, is being able to document and call out the issues that the young people they're working with face in a very non-confrontational way, to be honest. So it is heard and listened to, and there's a, I think YAP is a real trusted voice in the sector. And just with the other thing that's really clear about the way YAP do that part of the work, it's very consistent. And that's really important because these issues take time to address and you have to maintain the focus on them. And the app does that. And I think for organizations like the Children's Rights Alliance and their members, look, this is the success of our work is really reliant and dependent on the kind of work that the frontline organizations are doing in terms of addressing issues for young people directly, but also identifying them, verbalizing them and raising them and making the connections with where the systemic issues are. And the app does that really well, has a very good handle on what the day-to-day issue the young person is facing and why and where that links to the systems change that needs to happen. So I suppose just to conclude then, if there's any funders on the call, I would say we really need to see YAP in every county in Ireland, because you know it's not fair for children and young people who are missing out on this intervention and to see the impact that it's having. And I know YAP is really good value for money. I think it's really important that we support the work throughout Ireland, and just like to say to YAP, keep doing what you're doing. You're doing it so well, and keep the approach going. And I'd love the government to put a focus on just evaluating what YAP is doing and elevating it and promoting it as best practice for other organizations in the sector. And thank you, Siobhan, for your friendship and your collaboration and the work that you do to stand with us to fight for children and young people's rights in Ireland.
Thank you, Tanya. I think it is really, really great, and Niall mentioned that it, obviously, you know, when we put together our strategic plan, one of our objectives is to ensure that young people and parents' voices are heard, that the people who receive services actually are able to influence change and systemic change. And that's very important. And as you say, it is slow at times, but at the same time, it's really important. But also the young people and families we work with, we always ask them, well, what are the solutions? So it's really important as well that we're coming with solutions. And most of the solutions, as we'll see as we move along, are quite simple things that could be changed easily, particularly around communication. And so it's really important that we continue to work with yourselves and the Ombudsman for Children and all the other agencies, TUSLA and the HSE and the CAM services, to you know try and make sure that they can hear the voices of the young people and parents that they're providing services to, but also that at a senior management and at a systemic level, they're looking at how can change, small changes sometimes would make a huge difference to the experience and to the outcomes achieved for young people and families. So we're going to go on now. We have a poem from Rebecca that she wrote for us, which was lovely, and a testimonial from a young person called James from the Independent Advocacy Service.
My mom inspires me on who I am and who to be. If it's just to find my place or win a race, I'll always succeed in victory. She teaches me from right to wrong and in difficult times to always stay strong. Sometimes we argue, sometimes we fight, but then we make up to make things right. She leads me in the right direction to bring me to my succession. She helps me when I plead and supports me when I need. She helps me better than anyone can. That's why she's my biggest fan. We have our ups, we have our downs, we have our smiles, we have our frowns. But that's okay, when mom's here, she makes any worries disappear. That's how my mom inspires me to be the best that I can be.
How has mental health advocacy helped me? Mental health advocacy has helped me in many ways. For example, helping my voice to be heard at meetings and at care plans. It helped me speak up for my needs. It has also helped me understand myself and be more confident and strong as a person. It has been amazing, as it has helped me to understand my feelings and what support I need to recover. It has also shown me I'm not alone. It has helped me to use my voice and understand what I need. At the start of when I met my mental health advocate, I was shy, quiet, self-conscious. I never said what I needed, letting everyone choose what support I needed. And sometimes they got it wrong. But since I've spent more time with the advocate, we have resolved problems. At the start, I got the advocate to speak on my behalf. But now I've gained so much. I've gained me advocating for myself, and my voice is heard. I'm not as shy, I'm not as quiet. I understand what I need, and if I need support, I can ask myself. I think mental health advocacy should be accessible to everyone in the country, as it can change my, as it has changed my life for the better, and it can give a voice to others too.
Thanks, both really important pieces of work from young people. And again, thanks to all the young people who've put together pieces for us to be able to share them today. And now I'm delighted to introduce Debbie Von Tonder, who's one of our partners in St. Patrick's Mental Health Services since 2019 with the Independent Advocacy Service. Debbie.
Thanks a lot, Siobhan. Are you okay for me to share my screen? Is that all right? Oh, I think you've muted yourself.
I don't know that we can do that, Debbie.
All right, okay.
Because it's set up.
Oh, that's no problem at all. So I'm presenting St. Patrick's Mental Health Services, as Siobhan kindly introduced me. And we've been working with the Youth Advocate Programs in Ireland since 2019. So the background, really, how the advocacy service started in St. Patrick's Mental Health Services is that we had an independent advocate who was on extended leave and unfortunately didn't return to the service. So we were really quite urgently looking for an independent advocacy service. So really to comply to our own internal vision, mission and strategy, as advocacy is at the core of our service and really something we feel really strong about. So we were really lucky to go into partnership with the Youth Advocacy Program. So we commenced in 2019 and it's now embedded in the unit. It's a small unit, it's a 14-bed unit, but obviously it's young people with mental health problems, so the advocacy is really important. The service is delivered by one fortnightly group session and the one-to-one sessions is available as well. So we are working with the Youth Advocacy Service by building strength together, by helping young people to help themselves. And that is really very important for us. So it really is to help the young people to develop a voice and to be able to speak for themselves. So some of the topics that's discussed in our advocacy sessions are really focusing on young people's rights, to make them aware of their rights. So we look at what is advocacy. We spend a lot of time on the Mental Health Commission's Headspace Toolkit, where it really explains to young people what to expect from the hospital stay, what their rights are, knowing their rights under the Mental Health Act, focusing on the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, really explaining to them, you know, that they actually do have rights, and bringing that in as a topic as one of our group discussions, really focusing on resilience and assertiveness and encouraging young people to self-advocate. So really promoting the confidentiality around the one-to-one sessions and also making sure that they are aware of processes around commenting on issues or problems that they might be having, or if they want to complain about something, and making sure that they are aware of the avenues that they can take and using communication and really, really focusing on the communication processes in the unit. So what's really interesting is when the service started, we had from 2020 to 21, most of the issues raised was really complaints about communication or issues about communications, concerns about communication of staff. And that has gone down significantly from 2020, 21 to 2022. There was about a 30% reduction in issues raised about communication. And that tells us that the work that's been done over the last 2 or 3 years has been really solution focused and that the teams have really listened to the young people and really resolved a lot of those issues. Some of the project work, obviously was about promoting the independent advocacy service, how it works, what it means, what is available. Some of the other project work, which was really interesting for us to be part of, was the Mental Health Commission's project that they did with the youth advocacy programs around feedback on their posters and their questionnaires when they do their mental health inspections. And that was an exceptionally valuable piece of work for us because we really appreciated the fact that the young people's voice was heard and the feedback that they gave was exceptionally valuable. And it was really quite heartwarming to see that they really took part in it. And then also from last year's conference, the LGBTQ dictionary that we shared with the young people, shared in a unit, and actually is now in the whole hospital. It's in our information unit, information center, and it is available for all staff and all service users. And that was also, for me personally, really interesting and very heartwarming to see the young people taking the responsibility, but also taking that initiative and making it available. And that was really, really excellent. Some of the other project work also is the group quizzes and games, designing stress balls. So it's really interactive in doing creative work, but also really doing the really core work of advocacy is about getting young people to understand that they have a right, they have a voice, and actually using that voice. And it's not always easy for us as clinicians to actually get, you know, to have to hear the voice, because it's not always easy to get that feedback to say, actually, we're not doing as well as we think we are. So some of the outcomes and impact that we've had since 2019 up to 2022, some of the themes that's come up, as I've said, is communication of staff. That is drastically improved. Issues were resolved. Young people felt listened to. And really important is the relationships that have improved. The rights and responsibilities of young people is understanding those rights. And then also quite interesting, the policy and processes. I think there's often a sense that policies and processes are set in stone and that feedback gets heard but not actually actioned on. And we've had quite several policies being changed based on the feedback from young people. And to me, that is also that strength and resilience developing and for people, for young people to know they've been heard. So for example, the communication processes were reviewed and updated. The policy was actually changed based on the young people's feedback. Another policy that was changed was the social responsibility policy around recycling. What young person raised an issue about recycling and concerns about specific items not being recycled, and that's changed the whole practice of recycling in a unit, which I think was fantastic outcome from that concern raised. And some of the feedback from the young people is really really saying they felt comfortable raising concerns, they can work with the advocate. The advocate helped them to write a letter to the team that they couldn't use their own voice, but the advocate actually helped them to put their thoughts into a letter and actually use their own voice, and felt that they could express themselves afterwards. Certainly for me, it's when we started working with the advocacy service in 2019, we had a lot of development, growing pains, and the service now is embedded and it's actually going really, really well. And I certainly hope that we can work together for the next 20 years. So that's my story. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Debbie. That's great. Thank you so much. And it's really great to hear about the policy and procedure change, going back to the point around systemic change, that it is obviously important on an individual level for the young people themselves, particularly in relation to their own care plans, et cetera, but even more so to be for them to know that they've influenced change in processes and procedures. And that example of the Mental Health Commission is very interesting, because they have now revamped, as you know, their posters and their questionnaires after the feedback from young people, and on the basis that they really do want to get the input of the young people, but a lot of young people in the units were not responding. So they're very hopeful at this time, having listened to what the young people had to say, they will get better feedback from the young people and families around the inspections by the Mental Health Commission. I mean, as Debbie said, we've actually had mental health advocacy services. We started in St. John of God's actually in 2017. And now we're providing inpatient services to all the inpatient units, all the HSE inpatient units, and the two private units in the country. And that's really, really great to see. So we've grown a lot in the last period of time. We're also providing independent mental health advocacy services in some of the community teams. But as Niall said earlier, unfortunately, that is kind of sporadic, and has the full rollout for the country has not gone ahead as expected. We are hopeful, though, that we will continue to grow that, and that over the next few years, maybe even sooner, that actual service will be made available. We're all aware that there's a lot of difficulties at the moment within CAMHS with the reviews happening, both in Kerry, obviously, where the Maskey report came out last year, but also that now there's a review across all CAM services in the country. And so I think it's really an opportune time for the government to get ahead of that a little bit, and for the HSE to get ahead of that, and to actually make sure that independent advocacy services are in place. We may not be able to do very much about the past, but we certainly should be making sure the young people and parents' voices are heard now in the services that they receive in CAMHS to improve those outcomes. So we have a couple of little slides, some of which Debbie has mentioned. So in our community-based services, just as sort of an example nationally around the sorts of consultations that we have been involved with. You can see that parents and guardians often contact us first, and then we often then meet with the young people, but also meeting with the community teams is very important. And again, meeting with schools and advocating and supporting young people and families to advocate with schools has come up as a major theme. And then the second one is around the goals achieved during those consultations. So Debbie mentioned, within the inpatient group advocacy consultation, so this is across all the units to date, communication is obviously a big issue. Also issues around the living arrangements and living environment and policies. And so again, being able to work with the units to actually make positive change has been really, really important. So on that theme, we'll now hear from Mary Butler, TD, Minister of State for Mental Health and Older People. She wasn't able to join us today, but she has sent us a video, and we're very thankful to her for doing that and for taking the time to do it.
Hello, I was really pleased to have been asked by YAP Ireland to speak at your webinar, Building Strengths Together. Unfortunately, I am not able to be there in person today, but I am always happy to support YAP Ireland in any way I can. Improving all aspects of mental health is a priority for me and for the government. That is why we are updating the Mental Health Act, implementing our mental health and suicide reduction policies, sharing the vision and connecting for life. This year, we are also investing a record amount of over 1.2 billion euro for mental health. I appreciate, as do so many others, the great work of YAP Ireland, so that children, young people and families can build on their strengths, they can overcome difficulties and achieve new goals for each young person. This is an important day as you celebrate the launch of your annual report 2022, your new strategic plan 2023 to 2026, and most importantly of all, the amazing achievements of young people and families. Your theme, Building Strengths Together, is so important. Evidence clearly shows that by working from a strengths-based perspective, we can achieve better outcomes and better services. YAP Ireland works closely with young people and their families to develop their strengths to achieve the outcomes they want. This is achieved through vital partnership with young people and families, referrers, community and voluntary organisations, sports clubs, schools, and all the resources within our communities. Importantly, you also promote a rights-based and a person-centred approach. These objectives are also core for me as Minister in my current and future work. Meaningful participation and engagement by those using our care services are essential. As I have indicated on many occasions, protecting the mental health of all our population, including young people, has never been more critical. This has been reiterated by the experience of and the emerging lessons from the COVID-19 pandemic. We have all overcome many challenges in recent times and will no doubt face others to come, but the future overall thankfully looks brighter for all the Irish people. I want to take this opportunity to stress that any young person or their family who have concerns around mental health should seek help without delay. Our wide range of care services can and do provide real help. They make a real difference to many young people every day throughout the year, and recovery is possible. I wish you every success with your webinar, and I look forward to continuing to support the work of YAP Ireland over this year and beyond. Gurbh Míle Maith.
Thanks very much to Minister Butler. We're now going to have a couple of short message from John, who wanted to send us a message today about the App Ability Service. And again, thanks to John for doing that. And then we're going to show a video on the NUI Galway research into the app model and the aspects of the app model that really work.
Hi, John. How are you?
Good. How are you, Pete?
Not bad at all, John. Thanks for agreeing to talk to us today.
No worries.
I'm wondering, would you like to tell us about your experience of the App Ability Programme so far?
Well, my experience of the App Ability Programme so far has been very good, because I've having trouble with my sight and my mobility, and Yap have helped me usually to access the community and to get out and do the things that I enjoy doing, like swimming, going to the shop, going for a coffee, walking my dogs, just getting out and about and meeting with people. Like walking my dogs is a big one for me. Okay. And if I didn't have Yap, I wouldn't be able to do them things.
Okay, great.
I didn't think I'd actually be as good friends with my advocate as much as I was. I thought it would be more kind of serious. It was better than I thought it would be.
Before this started, my daughter was very withdrawn. She had no self-esteem, and sometimes she wouldn't feel comfortable around people. It's helped her through it. I thought it was brilliant. She seems more confident now, I think.
I have a little bit of life experience. I'm here because I want to help, and I think the young people know that. You're a wingman, and that's what they need.
For the kids, I think the impact's huge. With Yap, they go out and they have food. They can go out on a walk, and they can just relax. It's a huge difference.
Because it just feels that they're interested in what you want to say, and it just makes you want to tell them. She's funny and just listens to you when you need to say something.
Families have all these supports around them, professional supports around them, and everybody is focusing on the negatives. So it's really refreshing for someone like us to come in and just focus on positives.
Even things they consider to be their negatives, we show them as strengths. Young people trust you quicker when they feel you are on their side and that you are not judging them.
Children need and deserve to have their individual situations taken into account and reflected in the approach. It needs to be flexible given the nature of the young mind and the flux they might be going through.
I thought it was just going to be someone coming down and talking, but it was all about what you wanted to do. If you wanted to go somewhere and talk about something, you could do that. If you want to stay at home, you could do that. It all revolved around you.
Yap get people to go out, to talk about things. They're there if you have problems. They listen to you and show you ways to handle it. Normally I would lash out, but I don't really do that anymore.
When I had my Yap worker, we did do like dancing on Samba. The most important thing was space with the community. It was helping me to build my confidence.
I love the way all the kids are confident to say what they want. They're always there if you have a worry or you just want to talk to somebody.
They have a thing on a Wednesday now for parents, which is brilliant. You're not on your own, you know. I know most people think, well, this is only happening to me, but it is not. You can listen to the problems that they have and you can relate to them and then get ideas about going ahead.
We'd sit down with the boys and say, well, did we make it to the goals? What changed? What happened? Will we do this? That was huge, like. It was very helpful to have stuff like that.
YAP are good at reviewing in general, but even just on a one-to-one, it's very important that we see how far we come and remind her how far she's come. She forgets how far she's come, from that little girl who wouldn't speak, not to go out with her friends, not to go down the town, to this girl who just sat there in front of you and spoke freely.
We are there to empower young people and their families, to leave them in a position to be more capable of looking after themselves when we go. If we were with them for an unlimited amount of time, they may become too reliant on us and therefore unable to cope themselves.
Unfortunately, Dr. Carmel Devaney was unable to join us today. Dr. Devaney was involved in that piece of research, but also in the more recent research around the importance of participation and voice in the YAP model, and indeed generally within services, as Tanya mentioned earlier. So we'll move on with a couple of other short videos that were made by young people across the country. The first one was from Cavan Monaghan, and then we have Matthew and Siobhan from Dublin.
We're gonna ride, 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 ride till we fall. They say we got no future at all. They wanna keep us out, can't hold us down anymore. We gonna ride, 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 ride till we fall. When we hit the bottom, nothing gon' stop us. Climb to the top and you, we could be the greatest ones who never made it. Yeah, I could be talking to you. They tryna hate, but we won't change anything at all. Oh, we gonna ride, 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 ride till we fall.
Hello, Matthew.
Oh, I'm Matthew. I'm a part of this program for 2 months now, and me and my Africa Siobhan have been down hiking on Mount Stern. It's lovely. It's lovely. The forest is great. Having some crack out here.
Come on, Matthew. Keeping fit as well, Matthew, aren't we?
Yeah.
Keeping the head.
Legs are pumping.
And the head nice and fresh when we're out, isn't it?
Keeping fit.
Good man yourself.
If I wasn't on this YAP program, my mental health would be a mess and I don't know what I would be doing.
So soothing listening to that, isn't it?
It is. Going now hiking with my Africa is taking my mind off things. Being on this program has pushed me out of my comfort zone and made me challenge myself more than what I used to do.
Once again, thanks so much to everybody for that lovely little animation that they made in Cabo Monaghan. Again, it's just so amazing. We often think, and I know when social workers and others refer young people, they're very isolated. They're not particularly involved in anything. And then when we manage to bring them together through the amazing work of the advocates and building that trust, those relationships, when you bring them together, the creativity and the willingness to work together, the amazing kindness they show each other, the sharing, the empathy is just phenomenal for us to see it in operation. And for those people who've been to Croke Park, some of our national events, you'll have seen that in operation, where actually, you know, the groups of young people and their parents and families really support each other and are very willing to be kind and to offer support to each other. And I think we can't forget that, but also it's a real testament to the advocates that we have working across the country every single day, the amount of time and effort that goes into building that trust and to actually developing those relationships and making them work is huge. And the team leaders and service managers who manage all those services, as well as all the background staff who make sure that all these, that we actually have things like a strategic plan, a lovely glossy one, and that actually is a testament to all the staff of YAP Ireland, and a big thank you goes to them. So we spent a lot of last year working on the strategic plan. And again, we have our goals set and now we've broken those down into manageable tasks, hopefully. And staff across the organization are working on different tasks as other board. And again, we'll be consulting as we go along and see the change that wants to come about. As Debbie mentioned, sometimes when you consult with young people and families, they can tell you things sometimes that are hard to hear or that you don't particularly want to hear, that it seemed difficult to actually change. And one of our examples this year was when we were talking to the young people about the goals or the mission of the organization. And we had the word wraparound in there, and they got everything else. They agreed that we were strengths focused and community based and needs led, but they didn't understand the term wraparound. And we all kind of take for granted that people will. So when I explained to them what we meant by that, they said, well, why don't you just say that? So we did just say it in the end. So we have putting children, young people and families at the center of everything we do is now part of our mission. And so that's really, really important. Our values and principles, particularly as we've mentioned, the fun aspect is really important. The most important one for the young people usually is no reject, no eject, because again, most of our young people don't believe that that's the case. So they're used to being rejected and they're used to being ejected from services. And so it's really, really important that for them that stays front and center for the YAP model. And the individualized service is really, really important to them as well. So I suppose going back to our theme of today, and just to wrap up really, by working together and building on the strengths, we can achieve much more. And YAP Ireland is proud to work in partnership with TUSLA, the HSE, CAMHS, TESS, schools, the Children's Rights Alliance, the Ombudsman for Children, all the different organizations that we work with every single day across the country, all the small community and voluntary organizations that do amazing work on very little resources. And without them, our young people and families wouldn't have access to the services that they really need in the communities where they live. We're really, really grateful to everybody who does support us and work with us and offers support to the young people and families that we work with. TUSLA social workers in particular and our gatekeepers, you know, they absolutely work with us every single day to make sure that the outcomes that we achieve are shared across the client groups that they have to work with. We've expanded to try and meet some of the new demands that are coming through, but at the same time, we keep our eye very closely on making sure that our strengths-based model is what we maintain. So I'd like to thank everybody for joining us today. I hope you've enjoyed it. I'd like to thank all of our speakers in particular, all the young people and families and advocates and team leaders from across the country who contributed the videos, the poetry, the music, the rapping,
little voice,
and everything else. And that's really, really important to us. All the YAP staff who helped to put together the webinar, the annual report and the strategic plan, and in particular, Graham, Barbara and Marianne. We're going to finish now with a poem and then a video from Limerick, from the Limerick Young People. And the words in the Limerick Young People song are really, really important. What they talk about is, will you teach me to be brave? Will you show me how to speak out? And I think we can all say that, yes, that's what we want to do. We do want to teach them to be brave and help them to speak out. And we're really grateful to everyone for the support that you've given us over the last 20 years. And we look forward to another very fruitful 20 years. So thanks to everybody. Bye-bye.
That little voice at your shoulder gets much louder when you're older. It shouts, time is passing by. You'll never know if you don't try. If you listen carefully, you'll be following your heart. You are an amazing woman. Little voice said so from the start. Happy International Women's Day.
I've always wanted to try all the cool things that other kids can do. Communities that never seem to notice me. I want it all to change.
Don't judge by what you see. Talk to me and get to know the real me. We have lots to say if you just listen. Just wanna be heard. Oh, we're confident. We got a voice that is precious. Oh, will you teach me to be brave? Will you show me how to speak out? I'm wishing I could hear right now that I can.
Scared every time you try, your confidence will grow. See what you can achieve and how things can change if you just get involved in it.
Oh, we're confident.
Thanks, everyone, and everybody stayed with us right till the end. So thank you so much again to our speakers, and we look forward to continuing to work with you in the future. Thank you. Thank you to everyone who joined us.
Thanks, Siobhan. Thanks. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thanks, Siobhan.
Bye.
Yeah. Bye-bye, Niall.
Well done.